This podcast represents the opinions of our hosts and their guests only. The content here should not be taken as medical advice and is for informational purposes only. And because each person is so unique, please consult your healthcare professional for any medical questions. Welcome to Once Shattered, Picking Up the Pieces. Linda Major, Jack Major, and Ellen Bennett are three fierce advocates, two moms and a dad, who are passionate about changing the way eating disorders and mental illness are viewed in our society. Linda, Jack, and Ellen believe we need to stop the stigma, band together, and help people find resources and support early on. They advocate to foster awareness, enhance education, and improve treatment, as well as to help society understand and embrace individuals and families who are affected by eating disorders and all mental health conditions.
Thank you for joining us today. Our special guest will be with us in just a moment, but first, I'd like to introduce my co-hosts, my husband and my soulmate, Jack Major, and our dear friend, Ellen Bennett.
Welcome, everyone.
Welcome.
Welcome, and good to be with you again today.
We're back.
Yes,
and we're so back. Glad you're with us.
Thank you for joining us.
Absolutely. I'd like to start with a quote by Leo Basaglia today. He earned his PhD and went on to teach at three universities, and he authored a series of best-selling books on loving and human relationships. And I love this quote, and it fits in very well with our podcast today, which is Once Shattered, Picking Up the Pieces, Episode 105, Compassionate Care, Connection, Inner Peace, with Dr. Seema Khanija. So the quote from Leo Basaglia is, "Too often, we underestimate the power of a touch, a smile, a kind word, a listening ear, an honest compliment, or the smallest act of caring, all of which have the potential to turn a life around." What do you think about that quote, Jack and Ellen?
Oh, well, you know, from our journey with Emily and after her passing and all that we've done and learned since then, that's so important to care for each other. And again, with the COVID in the last 18 months and continuing on now, it should teach us how important it is to just smile and any act of kindness to someone. There's so many people out there needing so much connection and compassion. So yeah, that's,
I'm gonna say the power of a hug, given our experiences, just sometimes there just are no words. Mm-hmm. But that hug is a million words and a million feelings and a pile of compassion all in one beautiful movement. And the other thing is a smile. I think far too often we forget how powerful that is. And I think of when you're walking into the grocery store and you see somebody walking towards you who may have not have a smile on their face, and you just nod and smile, and all of a sudden you get this beautiful ray of sunshine from that person's smile. And if all of us can embrace that a little bit more and share that sense of caring across all situations, we
need it now. And there's a ripple effect to that too. Right. And there's so much we don't take for granted anymore. Like, it felt so good to be able to hug people again. I'm a hugger by nature, so.
Oh my gosh, I had to tie my arms down.
Well, our special guest today is Dr. Seema Khanija. She is an awesome person, and we're thrilled to have her here with us today. And I think the three of us are going to share her bio with you, and so you can learn a little bit about her before we interview her. Go ahead. You want to start, Jack?
Sure. So Seema graduated from Mount Sinai School of Medicine in New York City and completed her residency in pediatrics at New York Hospital Cornell Medical Center. During medical school and after her residency, she studied various complementary healing modalities, including, help me, Linda.
Ayurvedic
nutrition. Sorry about that. Mind-body medicine, yoga, and meditation. For 10 years, she practiced holistic medicine, caring for children and adults, with a focus on chronic physical and mental health challenges. She facilitated numerous classes in meditation, stress management, and holistic medicine for medical students at the University of Rochester Medical School, as well as the local lay community in Rochester, New York, where she resides. She is also a clinical instructor at the University of Rochester Department of Pediatrics.
Born in India, she spent her early childhood years there. Since her teenage years, Seema studied with spiritual teachers in the Hindu and Buddhist tradition and is also a student of A Course in Miracles. She completed a two-year online mystical mind training through Living Church Ministries and became a commissioned minister in the spring of 2019. Seema created Coaching for Inner Peace to help clients move through emotional and physical health challenges using their inner spiritual resources in a way that is deeply transformative and immensely practical. She also is the director of Shanti Academy, an online learning portal offering courses for students seeking a pragmatic and concrete way to experience inner peace.
Seema is passionate about integrating the wisdom of world spiritual traditions with scientific research to guide people to holistic healing. In her leisure time, she loves to take walks by the Erie Canal, create new Indian Western vegetarian fusion recipes in her kitchen, watch movies, Bollywood and Hollywood, with her friends and family. For more information about Seema and Coaching for Inner Peace, and you can enjoy Seema's website, coachingforinnerpeace.com. You can also check out her book, Physician, Heal Thyself, A Doctor's Journey from Medicine to Miracles, which is available on Amazon as paperback, an ebook, and audiobook formats.
Remember, all the links for today's show will be in the show notes.
Welcome, Seema.
Thank you.
Welcome, Seema. It's so great for you to be here today with us.
I'm honored. I'm really honored, and I'm really looking forward to this. So thank you for inviting me.
We all realize throughout our journey a little bit more of inner peace and compassion for ourselves and patients would have been so important. And I think we're gaining that insight into perhaps some of these teachings would be incredibly valuable in mental health and eating disorder communities.
Absolutely. So can you tell us a little bit about what you remember as a child growing up in India and your transition to our culture here when you came to the United States?
Yeah, sure. So my great-grandfather and my grandfather actually practiced a form of traditional Indian medicine, herbal medicine. And in our family, we just had different people practicing different approaches. So even as a young child, like, you had an understanding that first medicine, like, was food. So if something happened, your mom would do whatever. Mm-hmm. But then there would be elders. And then there would be, you know, our traditional, like my great-grandfather, you know, the shop in my on my dad's side. The first floor was his shop, his office. So you would see all these little vials of herbals and this, you know, from the basically floor to the ceiling. It had that odd herbal smell, you know. So
was his pharmacy.
There you go. Speaking to a pharmacist, you can relate to that. Yeah. So that was his pharmacy. And apparently he would know what time of the day to go to the forest or whatever to get those plants and which part of the plant and how to compound it. And all of it. And he would do stuff with like pulse, you know, pulse diagnosis. And so anyway, I didn't know those facts, but there was this like understanding of the levels of healing and how to get that support. And then you went to Western medicine when those things didn't work. And Western medicine had a reputation for being strong and potent and to be taken seriously. So you wouldn't go to a cult for a cold to a Western medical doctor. Mm-hmm. Things have changed since then, but that was the understanding. And then, of course, you know, you're surrounded by family. So when we came to America, all of that, in a sense, was cut, right? You're here in this new culture. I didn't speak English. Your parents, you feel like they're feeling a lot of stress, you know? They can't express it. Your dad's working all the time, you know, one job and another job. You don't have the layers of all that around you. So I think I remember coming to America and feeling kind of like alone, you know, mm-hmm. you know, like an alone experience. And then gradually you develop community and all of that. But I think the blessings of it was there was an experience that healing is wide and vast and can happen in many ways. And I think that stayed with me. So that spirit of healing, I couldn't define it, but I was sort of searching for it. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you had temple and prayer and meditation and yoga all on top of that. So it was definitely more than physical, you know, that mm-hmm. was already. So then how do you find that, you know? So that was the rest of my journey.
Wow.
I am enchanted by listening to your early years and growing up immersed in that family and culture. It's a beautiful thing. And I think we're all learning to really appreciate all of that culture so much more and embedding it into our practice. So I was listening to your wonderful book on Audible, and it was truly just beautiful to listen to. And it's evident that you have always had deep spiritual connection and incredible family support, generational family support, which is so beautiful. You became a pediatrician, a mother, but you didn't stop there. What drew you into integrative and holistic medicine?
Yeah, I share in my book that I had one of these like peak experiences. Abraham Maslow would call them a peak experience, and it happened in India. And I share that I was like maybe 17, and my parents just decided we're going to India. No discussion, you know, it was just, this is what you're going to do. And so I'm there and I'm miserable. Like I'm totally miserable. It's hot. It's like 110 degrees. There's no air conditioning. I speak the language, but culturally, like my mind is of this, you know, I want to become a doctor. I want to go to medical school. I need to improve my, you know, application. And this is not going to do it. You know, so what am I doing here?
Sounds like a teenager.
Absolutely. And as I share in the book, it's not that I was miserable. I made sure everyone knew I was miserable.
No. Surprise, surprise.
Exactly. You're going to share in the misery with me. So, and then during that time, we went on this pilgrimage, and it's Vaishno Devi. It's very common in the part of India I come from, northern Punjabi. It's something one does, you know, whenever you can. And my brother had been sick earlier when he was younger. And so my mom had said, the next time we're going to go, we're going to just do this as an offering, you know, of gratitude. And it's not an easy thing. You have to take like a bus, then a train, then it's a hike of like 10 kilometers. And then it's this cave that you go into. So all along this time, people are walking and they're saying, Jaya Mata Di, because it's a goddess. So Mata is mother. So victory to the goddess, victory to the goddess, as, you know, greeting those who are coming, those who are going. And at that time, it's in a, like in a mountain valley. So it's a precipice. So there was no guardrails. It's changed since then. So my thoughts as they were doing this was like, we're going to die. We're just going to die. Like I had no spiritual, nothing. It was my brother, myself, my uncle, and my cousin. So my parents didn't even come with us. That also was like, my goodness, you're making us go. But no, my dad had to come back to the States. He had to join a job. And my mom was taking care of her mother, you know, so mm-hmm. they had legitimate reasons, but a teenager doesn't think like that,
no,
right?
No, no.
So it was, you know, so we're going, and then we're waiting outside of this cave to go in, and there are people, and India, if you know, there's no personal space, so people are, like, jostling and, you know, kicking you, elbowing, who can go first? It's hot. And I'm like, what are we doing here? This is so, like, you know, this is supposed to be spiritual, and these people can't, like, what is going on? So my mind was judgment. And then I went into the cave, and I came out a different person. So I went in, and there's, like, there's a statue. It's not even a statue. It's really just, like, rocks. And then there's these three little things that signify this goddess. I don't remember that. I just remember the cave and how beautiful it felt to be in this cool space and the water that was flowing and the sense of, for the first time ever, my mind just stopped. Like, wow. just like that. It was just peace. You know, no judgment, no interpretation. And I just sort of instinctively, I reached for the water and I just kind of like put my, you know, just kind of taking in like this is holy water or something. Like I just felt that instinctively to do that. And I just came out and I didn't know what happened. I didn't know because I was resisting all the way. So then when I went back to America, everyone said that something is different. Like what, you know, I was less serious. I started to explore my Indian tradition. Reading, you know, the scriptures, the saints, even not just Indian, but, you know, American and just meditation, prayer, something, there was like a spark. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, it was that moment that reminded me something happened. I don't know what it is, but there's something here. I need to pay attention and who can help me? So that was the little kernel that then just kind of pushed me. You know,
mm-hmm. It's an incredible awakening within. Yeah.
One, how symbolic that is that, you know, it's in a cave with water flowing. It's very symbolic of like going inside to your own self and coming out.
So when did you
appreciating it in a whole new way? Just, yeah.
How old were you when you first came to America?
I was 6 years old.
Six.
Yeah.
And then you went back to India when you were 17. So you were here for 11 years
well,
or something?
Well, we would go for summer vacations.
Okay.
So this was just like, you know, our summer vacation time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Spirituality is a big part of who I am. And I think I could speak for Jack and Ellen too. And being that you're a physician that embraces all these things of Eastern and Western medicine and culture and spirituality. I'd like to read an excerpt from our book, and it's almost like I'm describing you and what you believe before I even knew you. So our daughter passed away from as an adult at 35 years old from anorexia. And she wanted her story told, and so Jack and I wrote the book, and Emily's writings are in there. And in the epilogue of the book, this is what I wrote. And it's the title of the book, I should say, is Emily, the Story of a Girl and Her Family Hijacked by Anorexia. So I'm going to read this, and then I'd like to know what you think about this, Ellen, and you, Seema, okay? Ellen, because you had similar experience, and Seema, because of who you are. So this is the excerpt. We often think about the medical care our daughter received and are dismayed at how she fell through the cracks of our current medical system. We wonder if Emily would have been better served if we sought out an integrative, collaborative medical team that embraced and utilized Eastern and Western medicine methods, as well as holistic practitioners. We believe a more personal and integrative approach, one that treats the whole person throughout their illness on all levels, physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual, would have been more effective. And I will say that Emily had a wonderful primary care physician, and she had some wonderful caring people that helped her along the way. But there was no connection. When you're in the hospital, you're in the hospital. When you go to see your doctor, you go to see your doctor. And there was no connective tissue to keep her healthy. And none of those medical places even touched on the spiritual side. So when you hear that, Ellen, being that you lost Katie, your adult daughter,
it really resonates with me because, oh God, this eating disorders are, the healing takes so much time. And what we now realize is it's not a short stint in a treatment center. It can take months. It can take years. And none of that was ever addressed, ever. And I think we're beginning to understand, and certainly this holistic approach in the continuum of care would be incredibly valuable. And initially, when you're in the depth of an eating disorder, the stigma, the shame is so powerful, and it goes for so long that to heal that, you really need that comprehensive emotional healing and spiritual healing. And I think, oh God, it can make me cry right now thinking about the emotion. The physical is one thing that's incredibly difficult, but the emotional is also heartbreaking. I'll get through this, people. I just take it as a course, and it is what happens.
Okay. Yeah. I know.
But, oh, I just lost my little, my crazy thought running through my brain. I recently, I was packing to move and found some of Katie's journals. And one of the little things I happened to read, and I was like, oh my gosh, how incredible, was she wrote down, I want to get back to yoga and meditation. And literally it was in the past week that I read this. So how powerful. Mm. And she was really sick when this was written. So there was that glimmer,
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to pass the torch.
Seema, Jack, you want to go Seema?
I just want to just witness to Ellen and just what she just expressed, because this is the essence of healing, you know? The essence of healing is it's a portal, a diagnosis of any sort, but especially something like eating disorder, which has, as you so beautifully, you know, the mental, the physical, the emotional, the family, all of those layers, is not a 15-minute visit, you know, or even a 30-minute visit. It isn't. And our healthcare system is what it is. So I struggled with that so much. I struggled with that so much because I could tell there was more. There was more. This wasn't the story. This wasn't the story. And in my time when I practiced homeopathy, because I did the pediatric medicine, and then I did integrative medicine, and then finally I went to homeopathy. I would have my first session with clients, it would be like 2 hours long, you know. And inevitably, I would have water, and I would have tissues. Mm-hmm. That was my mentor trained me, you know, tissues. Mm-hmm. And you would sit back, and he said, "You want to sit back and let them deliver to you. Let them." So have the space. And inevitably, there would be crying. Inevitably, and I would be like, "Oh my God, what did I do?" And everyone is like, and of course, little by little, I realized that there's all this emotions that have been packed that just haven't had space to be released. Mm-hmm. You know, so I totally feel this idea of integrative is the way to go. How to apply it and how to practice it is challenging, And sometimes, like you said, you have a great primary care doctor. And so sometimes we are the ones that have to do that for our loved ones. We need to fill those gaps and be willing, as you all are, willing to speak up. And you don't have to have an MD, you know, behind your, yeah, to do that.
It's about connection. So much of it is about connection with your medical team. And children, especially when they're adults, there's a window that is open when they are young. And that window closes when they're around 15 or 16, or maybe there's just a little crack. So what you used to say used to just filter in, and they took it, you know, they took whatever we said, right? And then that window starts to close and close and close. And then when they're an adult, they have their own autonomy, and they aren't so quick to listen. So we say the same things over and over, trying our very best, but somebody else can say the same thing, and whew, it's a revelation for them. And it's also, I think, so important for, other than wonderful supportive family, which is essential for anybody healing from any illness, it's also very important for them to see the hope in other people's eyes, other people that can see them through whatever illness it is, because that's grace, that's hope, that's spirit, that's all those things combined into one. And it does take a village, you know, it does. I believe that. Was there something you wanted to say, Jack?
Yeah, just in going through our repeated emergency room visits with Emily, it just always amazed me and disturbed me that they would come in, you know, the doctors would come in, the interns, whatever, and see this girl that they just saw maybe, you know, last week or days ago, you know, laying there, and just never tried to get to why she was showing up in the emergency room so often. They would, you know, they had to treat the physical symptoms because she was so compromised. I understood that. But after that, you know, why nobody tried to, you know, delve in and find out who Emily really was inside that, you know, that broken body that she...
Well, sometimes was. Even in an emergency room, I mean, that's just for...
I understand that. Know,
But for somebody just to take more of an interest and ask the right questions and...
But she was admitted, you know,
right.
a lot of the times, and she was admitted for days. But, you know, they never, you know, really sat down and said, you know, Emily, you know, why are you here? Well, you know,
I think it's that we all were painfully aware that it was deeper than what you see.
Oh, yeah.
It was so much deeper, but it was like, don't you see? Don't you? It was as if the medical community was blind to it. It was like, I said, they're shattered. I'm looking at our sign over there going, they're shattered inside. They're shattered. How do we pull these pieces back together? And it, to me, it felt like it was ignored.
Yeah.
It was just, and very hard to understand, because it's like, I'm seeing this. Why don't you see? Mm-hmm. Why don't you see beyond? Yeah, There's more. Yeah.
And it's a lack of education for medical professionals when it comes to...
Yeah, which I didn't understand back then. I thought, you know, you take her to the doctor, she'd get better. But I didn't realize how little education they had in eating disorders. And you know, so much of it's dictated by the insurance industry, too, as far as, you know, how long they can keep somebody and everything. And there again... If somebody's looking at, you know, these records coming in and these bills coming in for this girl over and over and over and over, and they're paying this, you think somebody would, you know, say, you know, why is this happening repeatedly? You know,
we begged for help, for more help, comprehensive care, follow up, all those things. And we tried our best as parents, but I think we need to get to the next question. So I think.
Okay. this is such a great conversation. I worked in education for 25 years, and I worked with K-12. So I've worked with little guys, and I've worked with older teenage students, and I absolutely loved it. And you have tremendous experience with individuals of all ages. So I'm curious, what have you learned about treating children in your experience and practice? And we all are realizing, accepting, and acknowledging that mental health impacts our small children at a frightening young age.
Yeah, that's a great question. And also, I'm a mother. You know, my son is 19. So I totally resonate with what you said, Linda, about there's that age when when things shift, you know, and what you said, you know, how it's received. So I've always felt like my son is like a Zen master. He always has been, always probably will be. And I practiced as a pediatrician. I also did a lot of work with children facing terminal illness. So I feel that, and now the epidemic of mental health, as you know, anxiety, depression, suicidal ideation, mm-hmm. suicide, you know, all of this is happening, not just in the general population, but specifically with that, you know, 15 to 25 or so and younger, and it's getting younger. And I think that what I've learned personally, professionally, all of these years, reflection, when you look at someone and they and you diagnose them with whatever, you have to be really careful. That diagnosis might be helpful to, you know, it's a constellation of symptoms, right? So you put it together in a package. But you want to be really careful because you do not want to isolate them from where they're coming as if now they're the problem and, you know, we're all the healthy ones and we're the experts and they're the problem. Even as a pediatrician, when I was working with mothers, I wasn't a mother yet, I would tell them that, okay, I'm the expert of medicine, of pediatric medicine. You're the expert of your child. Mm-hmm. And you're with your child 24/7. I'm going to see them 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. So we are going to work together, you know? So so sometimes, you know, these mothers would come and they would not be listened to. One mother came in and she brought her temperature. It was a digital thermometer where she hadn't taken off the number and it still read 101.3 to kind of prove that he did have a fever, you know, as if she wouldn't be listened to. And I laughed at that because it was like, you know, they weren't being heard, right? It was right. That mm-hmm. sense. So I feel when we're working with children, we must understand even adolescents, right? They still sometimes have a child brain. Mm-hmm. And I think you pointed this out, Jack, I heard you say this in one of the podcasts about, you know, when she was allowed to make those decisions. It was her choice. Well, is it a healthy brain making a decision or not? Right. So that's the thing. So and this is so tricky. I once was asked to run an adolescent clinic and I declined the job because I was concerned of what it would require me to do if an adolescent came to me with something, then I wouldn't be able to tell their parents. And that just, for me, just really bothered me because I was like, if my son or daughter, again, I wasn't a mother yet, but if they were pregnant or if they were, you know, facing something, I would want to know.
Yeah. Right. Right.
Yeah. I'd want to know. But there was this emancipated minor. And believe me, I understand where that comes from because in some cultures, you know, mm-hmm. so I saw it from all angles. I could see the parent angle. I could see the adolescent angle. And so I think this epidemic that's happening, it's asking us as a society to do a lot of soul searching ourselves, mm-hmm. not just put it on these, you know, young adolescents, like, oh, they're on, you know, it's social media. They're on this, they're on this, they're on this. Well, we're on social media. Who invented social media? And then the expectation. So mm-hmm. so compassionate mm-hmm. care has to be the connection, mm-hmm. you know, compassion for everyone,
right?
Yes. Everyone, including the providers, you know?
Oh, right.
Right, including us. So I remember being in the emergency room and doing write-ups and my senior, who I really admired, she said, you don't have to take so long. Why do you? You don't have to ask this. You don't have to ask this. And I thought for myself, like, why am I? Because I was always the slowest one. I was always the last one to finish. Like, why am I doing this? They get to go home and I'm still here, you know? And I realized I was doing this because I was listening to what the mom was saying, to what, let's say, if the child was old enough to speak, or I was watching the child, and I was waiting for that right and left brain, the intuition and, you know, all the knowledge to come together. So then I could have a sense from deep within, okay, this is what the next mm-hmm. step is. And that needed time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know? So incredibly important.
Yeah.
And refreshing to hear you say that, because that really, that's the core.
And a lot of times when you go to your doctor for a physical or whatever, he may not even be looking at you very often because he's looking at his computer typing. And he's doing the checklist, you know, about your blood pressure, your cholesterol, yeah. and all the stuff. And yeah. he looks at you when he walks through the door, and he looks at you when he says goodbye. And, you know, there's no contact and there's no personal.
Well, I think some are better at trying to get that in than others. But yes, yeah. I hear a lot of people say that.
But there's so many people frustrated with.
There was a point in your beautiful book where you a physician to a young child, and you took that you were very busy and overworked, and you want to tell them a little bit about that child you held.
Yeah. So this was when I think you're referring to when I was working with terminally ill.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes,
and
yes.
So I'll call her Karen. That's what I referred to her in the book. And so she was in with pretty much end stage AIDS. And at that time, there wasn't all the therapies that we have now. So it had been contracted at birth. And she was pretty much just, you know, not doing well, none of the remedies we were giving her were working. She had problems with her eyes, but she loved to color and she loved to be read to. And at that time I had done my residency and I was in fellowship mode. So I had a bit more time than residents do. And I remember just sitting with her and just reading, you know, just sitting and reading. And those 6 months that I did that work were the hardest that I've ever faced, because I felt the pain so intensely. And when I say the pain, it was probably all the pain I'd been carrying, all the years where you just don't decompress. So those moments when I got to do that with her, like you said, with Emily, you forget the medical, you forget the diagnoses, you forget where you are. You're just in the beauty of sharing a book with a child and just the energy of the book. And, you know, like you walk into a children's library. I love doing that, because even now, even though I have no, you know, child to get a book for in that way, but there's just a magic. Mm-hmm. And it, and I think this is the thing, like, you know, I was with my mom for something and we went to see her ophthalmologist, and he was pressured. He was rushed. He was fitting her in and he had a waiting room, and I walked out and I told my mom, I said, I don't know how people can do that every day.
Yeah.
Because it's an unhappy way to be. So I feel like those moments, again, nurtured me while I was. And I think that's what we miss, right? We go into medicine with real desires. I when I went into medicine, the dean of our medical school I was like 17, 18, and he said, your purpose is to alleviate human suffering. And I was like, whoa, I can alleviate human suffering? Like, I just it scared me. But at the same time, it just was like, whoa, this is huge. What power, you know, like in a way of like that I'm worthy, you know, this is possible. Mm-hmm. But then the follow-up isn't there. Like, how do you do that? How do you take care of yourself? How do you nurture yourself? How do you, you know, so I feel like, I think what you're doing, these podcasts and these messages, are so important, because it has to come from us. It has to be this grassroots level. It's not going to change from within.
No.
I wish I could say it would. For a long time, I had that hope that if I went into medicine, then I, you know, but I just had to follow my path and realize that everyone's following their path. But we need to honor the voice that's coming through us, which you all are.
Oh, so. Thank you. Well, what touched me about your book was the whole book. It was just wonderful. And so many of your spiritual mentors and teachers and people that you followed are people that I have read and followed through the years. And when I read that story, or when I read in the book about that little girl and you reading to her, you also read to her as she sat on your lap. And I just thought that was beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, I just thought that shows what an exceptional, compassionate physician you are.
You know, it's like we're all wounded. That's what I say. We're all wounded. Mm-hmm. And so when I sat with her in her bed and just read, and it stopped time, and it reinforced what was important. And having that experience, see, it's all related. So that experience motivated me to speak to my attending and say, what we're doing is not working. Mm-hmm. This is not working. And he really listened. He listened. So then I worked with a social worker, and we had her move to a like an extended care facility, but for children, where she was not, it was like a room with, you know, toys, and there were books, and it wasn't medical, but she would be supervised. And I wouldn't have gotten that. See, it was that right and left brain, you know, letting yourself have that stillness and experience. And when we let ourselves have it, then it actually was better for her medical care too.
So
she didn't need to be in a hospital setting. Someone else could, you know, be in that space. She could get what she needed. And then when I got, you know, she was loved, she was cared for. So it just needs that space and time, which how do we give ourselves that, right? That's the challenge.
Yeah. Well, in reading your book, I know that you yourself developed a very painful medical condition and that persisted for a long time. And it seemed to change everything for you and brought you to a deeper into your spiritual practice. Can you just tell us a little bit about
that? Yeah, definitely. I mean, yeah, that transpired over several years. And I was, you know, my son was like 5, 6. I was a mother and trying to run a practice. So I was a lot on my single mom and, you know, a lot on my plate. And that experience really brought me to my knees, because even by that time I had all these tools, but even those tools were not enough. You know, even those tools, which were yoga, meditation, visualization, affirmation, you know, all of these things. And that's when the Course in Miracles really became, you know, like I felt more and more drawn to it. I'd known about it since I was young in medical school, but that time it just really spoke to me more meaningfully. And I just really let my experience be a teacher to break down all the barriers I had built against myself and compassion, really. Against self-compassion, all the judgments and all the ways I thought it should be this, it should be that, all of it. I had to look at, you know, just everything, just on every level, and not alone. I had to be vulnerable and ask for help and reach to mighty companions, take time off, ask help for my parents, like really, because I couldn't care. I ended up closing my practice and taking some time off and not being sure what I was going to do. So it was one of those moments that just everything, it just, you know, everything falls apart. Like that's kind of what happened. But I'm grateful that I had the tools. There's a poem like with Rumi where, you know, he says, guest house, let everything that comes to you, let it be honored and accepted, because who knows, even if it's like violently going to wipe away all the landscape of what you know, I'm paraphrasing, it could be a messenger from beyond to lead you to some unknown delight. And that's exactly what happened. I didn't know that poem then, and it was really, really hard and it didn't make any sense. And that moment when the healing, you know, really helped, it was when I could just forgive myself for like not being able to, like there was almost this, you know, facade or this mask that I have to be this perfect healer, or the perfect mother, or, you know, like what's wrong with me? Like, you know, you shouldn't be having this problem. So all of this silly, silly stuff, but it was real, you know, and I believed it. And so I had to forgive all of it. And really it was, as what you said, it was self-acceptance. Just where you are is enough. And there is all the love that you want is here for you. And it's all okay. Everything you've been doing, there's no missteps. Everything has been okay. So that was huge. That was huge for me. And it really led, paved to coaching for inner peace. again, I didn't know all of that, but that's what it was doing. Yeah.
Beautiful. Linda and I listened to an old Super Soul Sunday with Oprah, and she was interviewing, what was the lady's name?
Carolyn Meese.
Carolyn Meese. Mm-hmm. And she talked about, you know, there's over 7 billion people in the world, and we're all here for a purpose, okay? And we're all going down a path, but so many are going down a path that wasn't meant for them. They're going down a path that they see their neighbor. They see, you know, all the things that they think they want and need. That, not that they need, they just want more and more. And they're going down this path.
They're taking a detour.
Yeah. And until you find the path that you're supposed to be on, you're never going to be happy. And you're never going to be connected to yourself. So that was very interesting to listen to her put it that way. Emily has helped me find my path.
Hmm. Yeah.
So true. I love this conversation. It's such an important one to let us all take pause and kind of reflect. And one of the things through listening to your book that really caught my attention and made me reflect is how often it's later in life when we have these awakenings of a more positive and compassionate framing of life events and circumstances. So my question is, how do we help young people embrace these concepts of self-compassion and love to build resiliency, to help combat the epidemic of anxiety, depression that leads to so many other comorbid conditions? How can we help? How can we encourage, awaken them?
Yeah, that's a beautiful question. You know, with the pandemic, with everything that's happened with learning and remote learning and all kinds of people, like my son didn't have a graduation because 2020 is when the pandemic hit. And so all of that was just skipped over, you know? So there's been, and I don't mean to say like, oh, people have lost lives. So I'm not trying to say that, oh, you know, that's huge. But there's something to be said about rites of passage and mm-hmm. ways to for a society to honor this is completed and now you're doing this. And we don't have those rituals. We, you know, some do, like in the Jewish community and other communities, some do. But often there's something you do on the side. It's not integrated, you know, or you do it because your parents are telling you to do it, you know, things like that. So I feel like we have to see who's before us and listen, you know, really, really listen. Sometimes we say teens and, you know, I hear this, they don't want to talk. They're in their rooms, they're video gaming. They're on, social media. Right? Like what's, you know, so parents like, so fix my child, like, you know, what's going on? But maybe they're shut down. Maybe they don't feel safe. Maybe they are feeling safe in that format, you know, where you can be anonymous a bit. So I feel every situation is so unique, but some common things would be to listen and for us ourselves to be seeing, what expectations do I have of this moment? What am I putting on this person in front of me? You know, like they're feeling to do this and I'm doing that. So the mental health system, you can go to someone and they can see you and they can put you on medications and there's a place for that. I respect that. But then 24/7, we're with our kids, right? Or our families. Mm-hmm. So what, I think it's such a deep question. I'm searching here because I just don't see that there's one answer in form because the forms can look so different. You know, my son decided to take a year off from college. And so it was to support him in that decision through family, through network, through space, through allowing. You know, so every child has wisdom within them and every family has wisdom within them. And so to lean into our own wisdom and feel safe to access that and then work collaboratively, you know?
I love that. And especially when you started with listening And in part of our journey, one of the important things is it's connection. And that connection is just, how are you? What's going on? Just being present, listening, and I'm going to say being present again, really listening and not dismissing things, and give time to the moment. And I love that you embraced, he's taking a year off. That's fine. It's a beautiful thing, because he'll experience, his path is going to take him and enrich his next decisions. And I think as a culture, we may need to kind of slow it down a little and take a step back and encourage that self-reflection. And
something that I find too with young people and with older people, when they maybe are stressed and maybe feel like they're losing some ground or their sense of purpose, is to ask their opinion. I think that's just a really great connection. You know, you have a decision you're going to make. It could be about what color to paint a room. It could be something substantial, something about a book, something about a movie, something about anything. But I think that helps people to realize that they matter. I mean, they matter. And even if they're young, that you respect them and you respect their
opinion,
wisdom and their opinion. Yeah. So, okay. So, Seema, your book, Physician, Heal Thyself, A Doctor's Journey from Medicine to Miracles, as I said, is so beautifully written. And there's such an important message we all need to hear, especially in these unsettled times. Can you tell us why you wrote it and a little bit about A Course in Miracles?
Yeah, I want to do that. But if I could, I just want to make one more comment about what you all were discussing before. And I want to talk about when people are having all of these mental health concerns, depression, anxiety, anger, eating disorders, it's almost like they're going into shadow. They're going into this darkness. And we as a society have trouble with that. Mm-hmm. We have images of success. We have images of what it looks like to be functioning adults, you know, like he's adult now, right? We say that. Mm-hmm. And I feel that when we see this pandemic, they're really questioning our models of success and our images of success. And so we're seeing these Olympic athletes recently that are the acme of success, and they're giving us these messages, I need a break. Yeah. I need to step away.
Too much pressure.
And with all the support they've gone, if they're feeling that, imagine us, that we don't have all that, right? So I just wanted to say that that's why we don't want to isolate a diagnosis to one person and make an interaction in a vacuum. It takes a village, and so we all need to do our soul searching and say, what does success mean to me? You know, how fast is it? How fast I get to something? You know, so I just felt like that's for me, that's really meaningful that we're having these conversations so we can all be raising our awareness and we can all be doing our soul searching. So we walk this journey with them, not like, okay, you've got a problem, something is wrong with you, get that fixed, then reintegrate into. Yeah. And they're like, you're crazy too. Like, why do I want to reintegrate? I mean, are you happy? Yeah. Like, they can ask us, like, I see you working all these hours and you're stressed out and you're chasing, you know, you're going in circles and this is what you want me to go to? No, thank you. I think I'll just stay. So you see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We're all here to learn together.
Right.
Right. And that actually takes me into answering your next question. When I was going through this, all this pain, I had the tools and I kind of like, you know, inched my way out of it and grace, all of that. But I felt like if someone else were in that position, I wanted to write a book that they could pick up, and whether they ever heard about A Course in Miracles, never, you know, wanted to study or not, that it could just give them this information in a way that would be easy. So my book was really to like, the book that I would have wanted to have, kind of, where I had to kind of go searching, you know, in all kinds of places. So that was my first desire, that, you know, this would be helpful to someone in that same situation. And then, as you know, there's a lot of stories about my father in the book. My dad, you know, I can say I became a doctor because my dad wanted me to become a doctor. You know, that would be a primary reason. And he just celebrated his 83rd birthday. And my biggest gift that I could give to him when the book came out a year ago around his birthday was, you know, thank you, Papa. Thank you for this journey, because the doctor, he saw, like I said in the dedication, he saw the healer within me that I didn't see. But he saw it in a specific form. And we both had to work together through a lot of forgiveness every time, like, there she goes again. What is she doing? You know, and God bless him. And my mom, you know, they just stayed with me, So I wrote the book as also to just document. I felt it was for myself to document this huge journey of forgiveness, of where structures and forms sometimes don't serve any longer. But the core of healing, the message of healing, which is why I'm so excited, because this is what I'm doing, right. You know, as I'm sharing this, still is alive and vibrant, and it just needs a different form, and it's okay to explore. So the book was written for personal, for that, and just for others to be helped if they were facing something that was just, you know, bringing them to this, like, nothing makes sense. And what can I pick up that can bring the science and spirituality and stories to inspire hope? Because Ellen, I think you said this, when someone is going through something, and this is the thing, the diagnosis, they're not their diagnosis.
No.
They're not their diagnosis. The diagnosis is helpful for medical, legal reasons, and it's helpful to get them services, and that's fine. And it gives us a sense of prognosis, even then, does it? Because sometimes people can outlive their prognosis. Right. So I feel like they're not their diagnosis. And so I wanted this book to be like, hope is always available to you, and inner peace is always available to you. You don't have to even physically heal before you can feel peace, which is something I never learned.
And that's so incredibly important. Oh, that inner peace. And I think what you just brought up has been our eternal frustration with the diagnosis defined them in so many, our daughters, in so many aspects. And it was like, if you only knew who they really, really are, you would know how wrong this is. Oh man, here I go, here I go. Oh. This is so near and dear to my heart. This entire conversation has just been powerful on an individual, on a global bit, just incredibly powerful, and to give us all space to be more compassionate and realize how important that is.
I always wondered what the doctor would do, or what an insurance company's decision would be if it was their child.
Yes.
You know, and the whole, my whole thought process is it could be their child, you know?
Well, and so much of the way medicine is practiced is dictated by insurance.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the insurance companies certainly failed Emily. So it's that system.
And that's why doctors have 15 minutes to sit there and do their checklist.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, so. Okay. We need to get smaller, not bigger.
I am so curious about coaching for inner peace, because truly we all need, even if it's just a little hint, we all need to know how to seek inner peace.
Yeah, so one of the lines in A Course in Miracles is health is inner peace. Health is inner peace. And I was getting, this was the stage where I had kind of healed from that pain. And basically I was feeling, I happened to be working with clients with disability. So I was struggling because it wasn't really fitting what I wanted to do. And I wasn't quite sure. And I had a website, and I had felt like I'd grown out of the website. And overnight, the website crashed. Just like that, it crashed. And then I was listening to my website person tell me what would needed to be done, and it sounded very complicated. And then this Coaching for Inner Peace came in because I had been thinking I need a new website name. That's also had been going on. And then suddenly this came in just like a flash of inspiration. I thought, Coaching for Inner Peace, that's like too simple. That must be taken. I can't believe that's available. And it was available.
Oh, we have an appreciation for that.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was available. So I was like, whoa. And then I was, you know, you called a GoDaddy representative to get your, and I was talking to him. He said, Coaching for Inner Peace. Wow, that sounds so cool. And it was almost like the universe, you know, was saying, yes, go with it. So it came that way. And honestly, I didn't even know what it was. It just was given. And it was my journey then to understand, what does that mean? Health is inner peace. Like, what does that mean? That sounds great. That sounds great. But when I'm in pain, when the insurance companies are not listening to me about my daughter, you know, and I know something is there, what do I do? So basically that was the question. And then I just, every client that came gave me a piece of it. And then I, you know, I had the format of what, everything was given through this space of self-reflection, meditation, prayer, looking at what people were facing, drawing from my own experiences. And so now I feel it's a systematic way to meet you where you are. It doesn't matter. That's the thing. It doesn't matter. It could be physical. It could. That's why the diagnosis doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. It's just an entry point. And then to listen and see what it is that your desire is, what it is that is your happiness, what it is that are your resources, and then take every person on their unique journey of really self-discovery. I'm working with some adolescents now, and I actually have a niece who's taken some time off, and she says, this is an existential crisis that I'm going through. And I love that she used those words. And I said, yeah, we should just take out, I see depression, anxiety, I see those as symptoms. Right. I don't see them as a, you know, like you, because we can all have depression. We can all have anxiety. We can all have days where you feel like you don't want to live. I mean, if you haven't had that, then I don't know if you're living on planet Earth, because there can be, or where you just can't stand someone, where you just feel like you can't, you know, deal with them. You feel frustration, anger, rage. And so for me, it was the normalization and allowance of all the emotions. So it wasn't like, I am peaceful, I am peaceful, I am peaceful, and chanting that way. No, it was like, I am enraged, and I am so angry, and I am so frustrated, and I'm feeling this. Yes, let's get those emotions out. Let's have a safe space. And then through that, what are the tools? You know, movies, as you know, on my website, movies, meditation. I, you know, we've used that in the group coaching and how people really resonate. So, so I was working with someone yesterday, and I said, yeah, you're going to get homework too. This isn't just, you know, you're going to be doing, and the homework is like fun work, you know, like fun assignments, because I feel this journey to know yourself ought to be the most amazing journey you can take. Like it should just inspire you. You know, you wake up in the day and like, what am I going to learn today from everyone?
Yeah.
And so I feel now in this moment, I have grown more than when I walked in the studio. Already I feel expanded. And so what if everything, whatever it looks like, is this, you know, as the Course in Miracles teaches, a call for love. It's all asking for love. It's an asking for love. And how can we, how can I, how can all of us together answer, you know? And so for me, it's just it's the heart of medicine. It's the heart of psychotherapy. It's the heart of any patient-physician interaction, because it involves me learning and growing and expanding and joining with each encounter. So there's a vibrancy.
Beautiful.
You know, there's such a vibrancy. I never say, oh my gosh, I have to go do this work, you know? Because it's, and I find when I'm facing something really challenging, those joinings that are called coaching are going to elevate me as much as the person. We're going to both be elevated together. That's something I never was really given in medical school. That's why there's so much burnout.
Yeah. There's so many doctors now that are leaving practices.
Absolutely.
Leaving systems and.
It's and suicide and drug use and lots of. Let's be honest. We have a lot of issues with that. We are wounded in our own ways.
Yeah.
Well, this has been absolutely wonderful, incredible.
Is there anything else you'd like to share with us, Seema? Anything else that we should know?
Yeah, I would like everyone to see whatever challenge, first of all, to see it as a challenge and to lift themselves out of any sort of diagnosis if they've been given something for themselves or their loved one, to see it as a portal, to see it as an entry, that there's all sorts of resources available. And it's an invitation to connect with parts of ourselves that perhaps we've lost along the way. And so it's really calling for, listen to me, I'm here to give you some gift. Now, you may not see it there. That's why we need the community. And to never feel, this is so important, to never feel you're alone, even if you're feeling not heard, even if you're feeling, you know, people are just whatever, whether it be in the medical profession or your family, keep looking. Keep looking for that, because there's someone around you that will be able to help you, you know, like with a smile, with a hug, you know, whatever it might be, small, it might be, it doesn't matter. But like, I think that's what I'm grateful, that there was something within me when I felt in medicine, I was a misfit and I was too slow and I'm never going to make it in the system. Something just inspired me to just keep looking, looking for a book, for an audio tape, for, you know, something. So I just want to encourage our listeners to not give up hope, that there's immense possibilities, you know, maybe just around the corner.
Right.
Yeah. Surrounded by opportunities, and each challenge is an opportunity for growth and not to get discouraged.
Yeah.
Be compassionate with yourself. And I, in my own life experience, I read there was a point where I say I had to reclaim myself. And that was huge. And it took time and it took compassion and it took reflection and insight. But once I reclaimed who I was in my true spirit, it's amazing. It's a beautiful thing. So I encourage everyone to be compassionate with yourself.
Yes. Thank you, Seema, for your presence, for your time, for sharing your knowledge and your gifts with us. It's been wonderful.
Thank you.
Speak for all of us. I also would like to say thank you to Scott Fitzgerald and Rock Fox for hosting our podcast. Just amazing job. And yeah, so thank you, Seema. Thank you, Scott and Rockbox. We're very blessed. If you're listening to this podcast and you liked it, please share it with your friends. And by doing that, you'll be helping us to spread awareness and compassion. And also, if you could rate and review it on the podcast platform you're listening to it on, we would be forever grateful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.